السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Dear brothers and sisters, we are going to talk today about filial piety, which can be roughly translated into بر الوالدين. The problem is very obvious and evident nowadays, that the aging population is staggering, especially the baby boomers nowadays reach their late 60s, early 70s. The life expectancy went up from 100 years ago, from the 40s nowadays to the 80s, 90s, and the 100s. I have in my practice several people who are over 100, and they come walking and they look so great. And of course, with the medicine and the medical care and so on and the surgery, it helped a lot to increase that life expectancy. And this age, which is here, we call it the golden age, but the Quran calls it أرذل العمر. فَمِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُتَوَفَّى وَمِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُرَدُّ إِلَىٰ أَرْذَلِ الْعُمْرِ لِكَيْ لَا يَعْلَمَ مِنْ بَعْدِ عِلْمٍ شَيْئًا. It's the old age where you do not remember and you do not know anything, which means when you reach the level of senile dementia. And nowadays, every dementia is called Alzheimer dementia. And Alzheimer is a scientist in the early 20th century called specific part of dementia which happens at young age for many factors. This is what Alzheimer dementia. But right now, any person in his 90s, if he is demented, they call it Alzheimer dementia. Many of this population have strokes and paralysis. Many of them, they have serious medical conditions like diabetes and complications of diabetes, amputations. Many of them, they have heart failures, heart attacks, been treated in the yesteryears for bypass and so on. And the list goes on and on. Not to mention losing their memory and their vision, cataract, glaucoma. They become near deaf and they lose their teeth, and their nutrition will become disturbed, and you name it. And several other cancers of the prostate and the colon and so on makes the picture very clear that this age is really something we need to sit down and think and ponder and take steps to take care of ourselves, because we are heading there, you like it or not. So the question here, what do I owe my aging parents? And what's my obligations? And from purely moral and ethical, secular viewpoint, because we know all religions, they honor the parents, as it's very obvious. Islam is very specific about it, and we'll come to that in the second part of this talk. So let's go now to anthropology. This problem is not new. It existed from the beginning of time. And among the anthropologists, after studying all cultures, civilizations, and nomadic life from Alaska all the way to New Guinea and Australia and so on, with the scarcity of the resources and with the mobility of the people, the handicap and the special predicament of those old population become very prominent. So there are some cultures, they neglect the parents, and they become prone more for disease and death. Others, they abandon them on the route. They leave them on the side of the road and keep going, the caravan, and till they, you know, die and from natural things or beasts or animals devour them. Some of them in Alaska, they put them on a sled and they, in a slope downhill, they send them, and God knows where they end. Others, where there's volcanic mountains, they take the parents up there and throw them in the worldly hellfire before the hereafter. And some primitive cultures, they ate their parents. And this is double benefit solution. Number one, they honor them. What's more honor than to you incorporate your parents inside your body and, you know, have them in every cell in your body? That's their excuse. And at the same time, you get rid of them. So this is in the cannibal and barbaric tribes. And some of the anthropologists tell us that some of them, they killed their parents. They murdered them to get rid of that burden. And no wonder they call them and call this type of behavior savages. And we think now we are, thank God, we are living in the 21st century and we are civilized and we are modern and we are humane and we take care of, you know, many things. But the situation is not far better. This savage's behavior is still exists, and we have a new modern savagery. And this is fulfilling the prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he described the end of time, or, you know, the advanced times, that antalid al amat wa rabbataha, when the children abuse the parents, and when the son abuse the father and prefer his friends over his father and the mothers, and he preferred the wife over the mother, and so on. But here, what I mean, the modern savagery, is the way we treat our parents in the West and the rest of the world, which is suffering nowadays from shortage, famine, wars, disruption of fabric of societies, and wars and failing states, and so on. So misery everywhere. And you hear a lot of stories of abuse and neglect. And here, to make things worse, we have the mercy killing. The mercy killing, when, you know, you give the permission for in the hospice and so on to withdraw treatment and give the parents, the sick ones, you know, some kind of sedation and oxygen and let him die. And but let's not go to the extreme. The general attitude towards parents, especially in the West, where there is, in the capitalist system, where there's a lot of individualism and the life demands a lot from everyone, the expense of living is very high, and the burden of the family and the wife and the children and colleges, and not to mention all kind of accessories to have two cars and a house mortgage, and the car's mortgage, and you name it. You end up with very little money, and here the parents come and share these resources, it become cumbersome. And we know that in this culture that children leave the house at age 18, and girls and boys, and they are on their own. And when they are old, the children probably haven't seen their parents in 20 years or so, and they are thrown in the nursing homes. And there's a movie in the year 2007 with the name Savages, addresses this issue about caring for the elderly, the parents. And it's Amazing how they use the same word, savages, for this type of behavior. It wasn't anything bad, just what I'm describing. You know, the son is so busy, has so much responsibility. The same thing with the daughter. Here's the father is senile and he's old, and what to do with him? They kept him at the son and things didn't work. They kept him at the door. Then they threw him in a nursing home. And then he dies there. So the culture here makes this predominant and getting worse even because of all these I mentioned about responsibility and so on. And in addition to that, the self-reliance where everyone has to work hard to survive and dependent on himself and so on. And the culture of the youth, everything has a glamour and glorified in this country, including the media, and everything is the youth. So here you feel the parents are neglected and so on. So no doubt that the parents, the elderly folks, are a social handicap and they are a burden, financial burden. And also socially, many of them, if they live with the children, there's the wife who is a partner coming from different family and so on, and become a friction and difficulties. And usually the son who is making the money, and he is the one who established his own family, and he has a responsibility towards the parents, get caught in the middle. Like the son, the song which says, torn between two lovers. He is torn between his, you know, obligation toward his parents and his duties towards his new family. And we don't have to talk about the culture of mother-in-law. And if you analyze it, it is economic. You know, here the mother and father invested a lot, and the statistics tell us a child till he finishes graduate school, you spend close to $1 million from the time he's born to there. And here the child, like a bird, flew away. Where's my $1 million? You know, if you have four children, $4 million. Why should I have children? You know, in the old time, because they helped the father in agriculture, in, you know, work in the field. But nowadays, why should I have this many children if they are going? And in the end, they will fly away. And all my investment is gone just to carry my name. That's a big, expensive thing to do. You know, I'd rather to have the $4 million in the bank, and when I'm 70, 80, 90, any nursing home, the best, with $5,000-$6,000 a month, you can, with some calculation from the brother who knows about money, you know, you can live 20 more years very comfortable, and you've been taken care of, your health, wealth, and cleaning, and accommodations, and food, and everything. It's a big problem. That's why nowadays you find the institution of marriage been attacked big time. The number of children are shrinking. Most of families have 1.5 or 2, unless people who are immigrating from lower or more primitive cultures, they have 6, 7, 8 children. Then very soon their children will learn the lesson. And people are not marrying at all. Half of the children here nowadays are born out of the wedlock, and 55% of them. And not to mention that most of the children now living with one single parent, alone. And not to mention also that, is it ecology or evolution forces and so on? Homosexuality come to the scene. And this is 10-20% of the population, which is a futile relation which leads to no children and probably better care of each other and so on. So to add to all of this, what's the benefit of parents to be living with you? I mean, if they are very old, handicapped, senile, they're useless. You know, they are just purely burden. And at any rate, even if they are okay, but just old, most of them, their expertise is outdated, outmoded, and not needed by the children, who are so much versed in computer and they can Google anything and get the answer, the right answer, not from a senile person, right away. And to add to that, I mean, those old folks, they need the children to teach them how to turn the TV on and use two remote controllers, you know. And probably one benefit of a healthy parent, all parents, to be a babysitter. Okay. But if we go to the moralist, the ethicist, the people who deal like lawyers, judges, Supreme Court, the philosophers, the university professors, from purely secular viewpoint, and invoke what the parents has done to the children, they are responsible for their existence, they're responsible for their nourishment, they're responsible for their upbringing, they're responsible for their education, and helping them to get married, pay all the expense of the wedding and all of this. And here he is, when he is very ripe, he's just started a new job, he disappears from your life. From that pure secular viewpoint, I mean, this is not fair. And they tell us that morally and ethically and from economic and value viewpoints, the parents, we owe them everything. We owe them the respect, the love, the life of dignity, and they need to be taken care of like you take care of the federal loans for education. And they are in trillions of dollars. And they are not excusable, as far as I know, and correct me, brother, if I'm wrong, that the loans the children take for college education and so on, you have to pay it back. No ifs and buts. So the same thing, the parents, they loaned that child a lot. Let's say $500,000. On what basis? He tells you, I'm a free man in a free country, and he, you know, split. Of course, there's no contracts, no papers. You cannot take him to court. Probably you can ask for support, you know. But, you know, so it is very wrong. And that's why that movie was titled Savages. Because this behavior is savagery. It's a theft. It is embezzlement. It is all kind of bad words. And cannot be done just because, you know, this is the society, the norm. The husband and wife, you know, newlywed and so on, and they go away and goodbye, and wait a minute. there is things to be addressed. So now let's go to the history, and let's go to the philosophy and cultures and religions. From the old time, Confucius, who was born in the year 552, and Confucius considered one of the moral philosophers and ethicists, and he resembled a lot Socrates. So he never claimed he's a prophet or anything. And we know from the writing of his students down the ages after 200 years, Mensae had a lot of the writing attributed to Confucius. And most of the Eastern religions in Asia and all the way to the Buddhist, Hindu, and Confucianism and Taoism and you name it, in Korea, Japan, China, the honor and respect and taking care and devotion and obedience to parents are unquestionable, of paramount importance. Everything in life is centered around this concept, including society and the civility and ethics and so on, all the way to the state and the empire. You know, he was at the time when he was summoned by the emperor, and I mentioned this one time, and he told him to fix the whole state. You need to fix the family, you know, to fix the relation between the children and their parents. And this concept, the filial piety, which is in the Chinese language, it is called Jiao or Chao, X-I-A-O. It is the devotion and the care and obedience to parents which lead to li. And li is the ethics and the moral obligation which cover all the fabric of society. And this leads to ren, which is a love to the state and the humanity. And here you find love everywhere and respect and compassion covering everything. That starts from the parent and the family, and the children care for the father and mother. Socrates also, and you know, Socrates is also a philosopher who never wrote any word. So everything we know about him is through his student, Plato. And according to Will Durant, Socrates is half a myth and half a man. So because we don't have any much evidence outside Plato. Plato in his dialogue, one of the chapters titled Crato, here Socrates was sentenced to death by the democracy of Athens, and the accusation was that he's corrupting the youth. And that was impossible because he was one of the great figures in Athens. He was Athenian, he was smart, he was a friend of Pericles. They attended so many of the theaters and they used to love those tragic plays and so on. So he is not nobody. Anyway, he was sentenced to death by drinking the hemlock, the poison. And here their students, I mean, they were irate and they were influential and they were ready to, you know, to have him escape. Even they bribed the guards and everything been taken care of, but he just has to take his bag and leave. But he refused. And in this dialogue, Crato, he cites the structure of the society and the duty towards the parents. And from the parents come the fabric of society, then come the state, and obedience of the law is so of paramount importance. So he stayed where he is to receive his death, and he drank the hemlock and he died. So the filial piety is a virtue and primary duty of respect, obedience, and care, and devotion to one's parents without ifs or buts. You might tell me, you know, not all parents are benign, you know, many parents are really bad, you know, they're malignant, or they are maybe kafir, mushrik, non-believer, and maybe they entice you to do bad things. There's parents who order their daughters to go into prostitution, and others tell people, you know, to their children to disobey or deny God and so on. All these things does not relinquish your responsibility towards your parents. If they are a mushrik, if they are themselves very lousy, they cheat their wives, they have mistresses, they do everything, they scar the children and so on, you know, this is not an excuse for abusing the parents. And we know from the prophets, many of the prophets have suffered in this issue. Like Ibrahim alayhi salam, his father was ordering him to worship idols. We don't find Ibrahim abusing his father. It's quite the opposite from the verses of the Quran. He addresses him with the most tender, loving, caring address, Ya Abati, Ya Abati. Then he threatened him to kill him, and he kicked him out. And he told him, I'm going to pray for you, and so on. And he left. The same thing, you know, there is lessons to be learned from Noah, from Ibrahim, from Lut, from the wife of Pharaoh, and so on. All of them are situations where you find things not perfect between the father, mother, and the child. But all these conditions, all these varieties or variables does not give any or relinquish the responsibility, the basic human responsibility of devotion, taking care, obedience, and attending to their needs, and so on. We know Amr al-Qais, when his father was killed, and he is a poet, his father was a king of Kinda, and when he was killed, he brought the subject like he wanted to escape the responsibility, because he was a playboy and he was drunk, and you know, he probably cannot take the responsibility of the kingdom and so on. He cited that my father wasted me, ضيعني صغيرة, like he wanted that an excuse, you know, to not take care of the issues and so on. Also, another story, when the man brought his son and came to Umar ibn al-Khattab and told him, this is a lousy son, he's not taking care of me, and he cited many things. And Umar ibn al-Khattab, as a judge, he listened to the other part, and the son told him, I mean, he has chosen the worst mother, probably she was a prostitute or something, a bad example, and he named me the worst of name. He called him Ju'l, which is like a beetle, and he did not educate him and so on. So Umar ibn al-Khattab, after he listened to a long list of abusement from the father towards the son, he told them, عَقَقْتَهُ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَعُقَّكَ. You disobeyed him or disfavored or did wrong things toward him before he has done the wrong things towards you. And now you have the grievance and coming to me. So, but this is also is not an excuse to abandon or abuse the parents. We know from the turn of the 20th century, there was a philosopher, the first probably one who established psychiatry and psychology in the United States in Harvard. His name is William James, and he's a brother of Henry James, who was an author and novelist. So William James, he's the owner or the founder of, co-founder of the School of Pragmatism. And he addressed this issue of the family and that this obedience and taking care of the parents is very important in the health of the children and society. And he implemented his methodology that whatever works and benefits society is good. So he doesn't believe in abstract and lessons and so on. That's why it's called pragmatism. And that in caring for the parents and so on, we have to experiment and see what outcome is better. To do what we're doing, neglecting them and so on, and is it society as a whole will be happier society or more prosperous or whatever criteria? The answer is no. So that's one more pragmatic reason for taking care of the parents, because the children who are living with the grandparents in the larger family are healthier, more solid in their behavior and psychology and structure, and also the society as a whole of those who have large families are much healthier with less incidence of heart attacks and diabetes, though they have other risk factors for these problems like cigarette smoking. And they found this in the immigrants, studying the immigrants from Italy and Sicily and so on, who lived in the, for the first generation. Then they become in the melting pot. The second generation have the same statistics like the rest. They found the people who have, live in larger family structure, they are healthier from health viewpoint, less diabetes, less heart attack, less strokes, less high blood pressure and so on. So, what does Islam say about this issue? I know what I'm saying is ABC for all of you and well known to every child in every school. And that falls under the title, Birrul Walidain. In the Quran, you don't read any verse which touches on the subject where address the issue by using عقوق الوالدين, disobedience to the parents. Like, it's unspeakable. You cannot utter it to say that God telling you, don't abuse your parents. It's unspeakable. Always comes in affirmative, positive statement, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And ihsan is the best of the treatment, the excellence of a treatment. Nothing above it, of devotion, love, care, and you name it. And the many ayahs I'm gonna mention, always, what's the most important thing in Islam? Believe in God and the oneness of God and attribute no partner to him. That's a major issue. And this is the most important thing. If you attain it or you're saved, regardless the rest of your records, you know. In the Quran we read, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ. وَقَضَى, it's in the past sentence. It has been done. It's sealed. It's been ordained. It's been signed. It's been a covenant with humanity from the time of Adam till now. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ. You worship none but God, your creator and creator of everything. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Then comes taking care of the parents. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Always when the commandments comes like this, always it's paired with the worship of God, taking care of parents. إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ. When they get old and they live with you, one of them or both, you cannot say even uff. And uff in Arabic, not F, the letter F in English, which you cannot say it, of course, to anyone. It's uff means the least of discontent or the wishes not to answer or reply. And if there was anything less, God would have used it. So you cannot tell your parents uff. And of course, anything more than that, وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. I mean, anything, it's obvious. If you cannot say off, you cannot, you know, answer them back or talk back to them or argue with them or decline what they ask you and so on. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. And it is obligatory on you to answer them with the most gentle, kind, generous way. وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. You be humble in front of them out of love and mercy on them. And وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. And you pray to God to have mercy on them as they have been the source of your existence and your upbringing and spending all this $1 million to make you a man or a woman and educate you and teaches you moral values and so on. وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. And you know, none of us, no child can live one day or one night without care. He will perish. And all of us, we know how father and mother, how they take care of the baby till he is. And this kind of ayah is present in the Quran more than 10 times or so. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانِ. This is an order, commandment from God to every human being. And here he's not telling the believer or mu'min or Muslim. Insan means generic for humanity, human name, human, any human. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. Ihsan, again, the best of the treatment, the excellence of treatment. And here cites, to remind you, just little glimpses. حملته كره أمه كرها ووضعته كرها. Remember what your mother went through, carrying you 9 months, and the pain and suffering of labor and delivery. A man carried his mother the rest of her life on his back to the Hajj and so on, and he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him, did I fulfill my duty towards mother? Told him, everything you did is with one uterine cramp during your delivery. I mean, you cannot compensate your parents whatever you do. You cannot. You cannot make him exist, you cannot make him nurtured and so on. So the least you can do is to take care of them these few years or the end of their lives. In another ayah, anishkur li wa li walidayk, thank me. And you know, Islam, half of it is shukr. Wa qalilun min ibadiyya shakur. That's what we're supposed to do to God. He doesn't want any old jumbo mumbo we see all around us. He wants you to be thankful to him. And thankful is not a lip service. We know, we talked about it many times. An ishkur li wa li walidayk. So how can I take care of, do shukr or thanking my parents? Not lip service, to take care of them the rest of their lives. And let's see here the bad parents who are dictating on you or telling you to do bad things. وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ, here, جَاهَدَاكَ means big efforts and toiling and striving for you to change your religion, to disbelieve in God or believe in other gods or attribute to God any partner or son or anything. وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ, things nor you nor any other, you know, what they're uttering. I mean, there is no proof for it. فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا, you do not listen to them in that regard, but you take care of them the rest of their lives. وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا, so you take care of them the rest of their lives. And we know that in Islam, we don't use the word haram, the jargon in the fiqh, except what it is in the Quran, very precise, you know. Though we use haram loosely for other things, you know, but we know the fuqaha, if they don't like something, he tells you, I don't like it, I don't think it's right, but he tells not, tell you haram. The ignorant, the mediocre, knowledgeable people, they right away, they classify thousands of things, haram, and so on. You tell them, calm down. Haram is what's in the Quran, what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained very clearly. And there are very few things. And here in this ayah in Surah Al-An'am, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ تَعَالَوْ أَتْلُ مَا حَرَّمَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ. Come here, let me tell you what Allah made unlawful, haram, on you. أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. Do not attribute any partner to God, the oneness of God. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. What is haram is عُقُوقُ الْوَالِدَيْنِ, not to obey, respect, devote, and take care of your parents. This is haram, unlawful. And the other ayahs, so many, and always I said, it comes with the oneness of God. So you don't, you know, the oneness of God is the epitome of the aqidah, the tenet of faith, the articles of faith. The highest one is worshiping God and the oneness of God. Immediately comes attached to it, taking care of the parents. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Now we come to a hadith, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in many a hadith, and I had all of this from Shu'ab al-Iman, and they are variable in their strength, some of them muttafaq alayhi, or Bukhari, or Muslim, or the other scholars. So Shu'ab al-Iman, Imam Bayhaqi, so you can find all these hadith there. So one hadith says, رِضَ اللَّهِ مِنْ رِضَ الْوَالِدَيْنِ, yani, which means God pleasure with you comes through the pleasure of your parents. رِضَ اللَّهِ مِنْ رِضَ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. So you, if your parents are pleased with you, God is pleased with you. وَسَخَطُ اللَّهِ مِنْ سَخْطِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. And if God is angry with you, it's because you angered your parents. And we know that our passport to heaven, and all of us, we want immortality, we want to be in the Day of Judgment, you know, treated easily and ushered very quickly to heavens and the highest level in heavens, enjoy everything there, and also see God as an ultimate reward, okay? So if this is the ultimate goal for all of us, to gain the paradise and heaven, let us remember, where is that heaven? Where am I supposed to look? Don't look far away. Look at the feet of your mother. There, you stick at the feet of your mother. And we know the statement when the man came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he wanted to join the army and defend the land, the homeland, and so on. And he asked him, do you have a mother? He said, yes. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, فَالْزَمْهَا, you go and stick yourself with your mother, take care of her. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ عِنْدَ رِجْلِهَا, in another narration, عِنْدَ قَدَمِهَا. The whole heaven, which all of us were looking at it, is under the feet of your mother. That means when you take care of the mother, you take care of yourself and you gain the heavens. In another hadith, which I thought to, till I read this reference, that it was a statement derived from this hadith, al-jannatu tahta aqdami al-ummahat, that heaven is under the feet of the mothers. I thought this is a statement which derived from the hadith, but in one of the books I have, I found that al-Khatib al-Baghdadi in his Jami' an Anas ibn Malik consider it as a hadith. So the meaning, the same thing. And you find a lot of calligraphy, you know, there's a lot of ayat of the Quran in calligraphy, and you hang it on the wall of most of the Muslim houses. And the same thing, many of the ahadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you find it written in calligraphy, beautiful and framed and hanged. And one of these is al-jannatu tahta aqdami al-ummahat. It's unfortunately when the husband get married and have a wife, and his mother is still alive, the wife managed with the smartness and to hide or take this framed calligraphy and hide it in the attic or in the basement. Okay, so he wouldn't remember that heaven is under the feet of his mother, her mother-in-law. And you know the animosity. Till the mother dies, and that woman become in her 40s and grow up, and she had children now, and she is now becoming the mother. She goes and dig in the attic or in the basement and find that and hang it in the best prominent place in the house. Al-jannatu tahta aqdami al-ummahat. Some of those toxic ladies, they want to win it both ways, when they are wives and when they are mothers. And some of them, they get away with it, you know. But don't go far away, because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that many, many of the wrong things we do in life, you think you get away with it and your judgment will be in the hereafter, but not the disobedience, disrespect of the parents, because the punishment is now and here. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "كل الذنوب تؤخر إلى ما شاء الله إلى يوم القيامة إلا عقوق الوالدين فإنه يجعله لصاحبه في الحياة قبل الممات." In this life, before the hereafter, and I have seen a lot of miserable people who were disrespecting of their parents, and we need to pay attention to that. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, "Man ahaqqu an-nas bihusni sahabati," which means sohbati. All of us, we know this hadith. "Qala ummuk," "Qala thumma man," "Qala ummuk," "Qala thumma man," "Qala ummuk," "Qala thumma man," "Qala abuk." Another man, he came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he wanted to make hijrah from Mecca to Medina. But he told him, I came to you to pledge the hijrah, but I left my parents, they are crying for my departure. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, go back and bring happiness to their hearts instead of making them cry. فَأَضْحِكْهُمَا كَمَا أَبْكَيْتَهُمَا. One of the middle doors of heaven is the door of the Father, where entered especially by those who listen to their fathers and obey their fathers. And you know, the father who gives his name to his son, and the son gives his name to the, and he gives them the X, the Y chromosome, and he's, you know, the stock A owner in that corporation of the marriage. He has vested interest in that child to grow up and to be healthy and wealthy and successful. So if his wife, and she's a bad woman, and she tried to derail him and make him become lousy or drunk or on drugs or whatever, the father has the authority to order his son to divorce his wife. And as I read, this option is not present for the mother, because the mother, most of the time, there's a lot of emotions involved and passion, and you know, things which might regret later on. So the father, and this happened with Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he saw Ismail's wife is an unthankful lady. With everything he's doing to her, he came and gave him indirect commandment that it's about time to divorce this woman. So one of the middle doors of the heaven is called the door of the father, where entered by those who listen to their parents. One time, a father and a son came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he complained that my father wants my money. أتاه رجل فقال يا رسول الله إن لي مالا وولدا وإن أبي يحتاج مالي. The Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and this is exactly what the moralist and ethicist has, and the economist and those who understand the value of time and efforts and investment and everything, that's exactly what Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said 1,400 years. He told them, أنت ومالك لأبيك. All of you and your existence and your money and all your what you have done in this life belongs to your father. It's his investment. Without him, you would be nothing. And then he commented, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Inna awladakum min atyabi kasbikum." He considered the children as an investment and earning in this life. It's not an adventure or venture of raising kids, then they fly away and they disappear after spending $1 million on them. Just that from economic viewpoint, not to mention incalculable of love and care and compassion and protection and so on of the mother and the father every minute of the day, every hour of the, and every week and every year. Tell me any parents who would they, their eyes taken away from their children in a second. They are like a stream of consciousness in their mind and heart, every second, every minute. And now he got married and he, oh, goodbye. Wait a minute. There's a lot of debts to be paid. And that's why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this equation said, لَا يَجْزِي وَلَدٌ وَالِدَةٌ. La is nafi al-jins, which means never you can pay your father. La yajzi waladun walida, narrated by Imam Muslim. You never can pay your father your dues. He was responsible for your existence, your nourishment, your education, your well-being, and you name it. Aqooq al-walidain is one of the kaba'ir, as we have said, and as in the hadith, al-ishraku billah wa aqooqu al-walidayn, to attribute partner to God and to disobey your parents. This is the paramount of the cardinal sins in Islam. Another hadith by Ibn Bukhari and Muslim, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ عُقُوقُ الْأُمَّهَاتِ. In another hadith, لَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّ عَاقٌ. The Jannah with millions of people there, you don't find one single of them in heavens who disobey his parents. لا يدخل الجنة عاق. So you have to solicit the blessing and the rida or the consent or the happiness of your parents with you and be very keen on it. And we need to teach the kids this. There's a lot of stories which, and you know, stories is the most important thing for to convey meaning to the children. There's a story of the cave where three men were caught in the cave with a big rock on the door. One man cited, "Oh Allah, I took care of my parents. In the evening, I bring him milk. I found him asleep. My wife is crying. My children are crying. And I refuse to let him drink of it till my parents, I don't wake my parents up. Till they wake up on their own, I give them the milk and they drink it. Then I give my children and my wife. If I done this to please you, help us here." And the rock was moved out. Of course, there's other two men who told their stories. And this is authentic. There is the story of Juraij al-Abid, where this man who thought he knows God and he is worshiping God, but when his mother called him, he did not answer her. And long story, but he was destroyed of that. And here the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that if Juraij al-Ab al-Rahib كان فقيا عالما لعلم أن إجابته أمه أفضل من عبادته. When answering your mother is more important than your prayer. Of course, now the fuqaha here, they tell us it is the fard and sunnah and so on. Of course, it depends on the emergency. If the mother said, "Come and help me, I'm choking," or whatever emergency, you leave any prayer and you go and jump to her, help her. But here in this story, she wanted just to ask him a question. And I know you got to interrupt your salah, especially if it's not fard. I know the scholars differ on that, but you go and answer your mother. You interrupt your salah, which is you are talking to God. You interrupt your salah to answer your mother. What do you want, mother? And the third story of that man who could not, he's dying, he could not say La ilaha illallah. And you know, all of us, we have when the last word we utter, to attest that there's no God but God and that the Prophet Muhammad is messenger. So in this story, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was summoned to help out and he found out that this man did not obey his mother and he brought the mother, he told him, "Your son is going to hellfire, I'm going to start the fire now, you know, to show you how he's gonna burn." You know, the mother heart said, "No, no, please, I'm happy with him, I forgive him everything," till he was able to say La ilaha illallah and then die peacefully. You know, the mother heart is amazing. You know the story of Sulaiman alayhi salam when two women fought for a baby and the true mother could not bring any evidence and so on except here Sulaiman, he said, "Well, okay, I'm gonna be fair with you guys. And I'm going to cut the baby in two halves and give a half to everyone." The true mother said, "No, no, 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 he's not my baby. Let the other woman take him alive," you know. So the mother heart is amazing. More than that, and this is very important, one of the major sins to bring any negative things to your parents, okay? Inna akbar al-kabair, I'm almost done, an yal'an al-rajulu walidayh. And the people said, "My God, who would curse his parents?" He said, "يَسُبُّ أَبَى الرَّجُلُ فَيَسُبُّ أَبَاهُ وَيَسُبُّ أُمَّهُ فَيَسُبُّ أُمَّهُ." Here, when you transgress against others, they will curse you and curse the one who brought you to this life and the ones who nurtured you and taught you moral values. So don't do anything wrong in society, from parking your car in the wrong way, because that might bring cussing towards your parents. And this is a lesson for us, not, you know, from all the religions. Confucius talked about this, and your excellence in work, in your success in life, and being kind, gentle, moral, all of this will bring either blame or complement to your parents, and you have to be very careful. So this is very important subject, brothers. We need to revisit, and though we know all of it, I'm not bringing anything new, but you need to sit down, educate your children, educate yourselves, and educate your women, and everyone needs to know his space and not to transgress against each other. And I know there's duties and rights for everyone. May Allah bless you all. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.